Good morning, everyone. It's good to be here today. I am grateful for the opportunity to worship. And that is why we've come. We've come to worship. We've come to worship the Lord our God, to give him praise, to give him honor, because he is worthy. That is why we are here. So I welcome each of you on this, our Lord's Day, and I trust that it is well with your souls. It is my heart's desire that as you grow spiritually, you will prosper. And as you prosper, you will not stop growing spiritually, but will continue to draw closer and closer to the Lord. You can go ahead and turn your Bibles into Romans chapter 9. And I pray that you guys will be patient with me. I just want to hear what God's word has to say. And I don't feel like I need to be in a hurry to do it. I want to be able to hear, as you read Brother Dave read this morning in Jeremiah 18, the word of the Lord came to me. And honestly, isn't that what we're after? We want to hear a word from God. Quite frankly, I have nothing to say of value. But if we can hear the word of God through this earthen vessel, we will be better off. So it's the word of God that we're after here today. I will look at this morning Romans 9, 19 through 21. That'll be our passage for this morning. That's where we want to labor. That's where we want to focus. And if you're looking for a big idea or a topic or a sermon title in this segment, we're going to talk about an objection to God's sovereignty. We have determined that here in chapter 9, Paul is trying to establish the sovereignty of God in his dealing with Israel, the sovereignty of God dealing with humanity, the sovereignty of God over his entire creation. And today we'll look at an objection. Now I want to share something with you, and it's always risky when you share personal things, but it's just one of the ways that I've learned to communicate. I don't know if this is just my age or as I get older, but I have found out that I like having conversations with myself. I talk to myself. And Rodney, I have gotten to the place I answer me. I'm just telling you the truth. Sometimes I might be at my office desk at home and I'm reading and I'm studying, and I will become audible about what I'm reading out loud. Or I'm walking around and I'm doing something and I just start to open my mouth about what's going on in my mind. And I see something here in this text today that reminds me of myself. Paul just simply puts it like this in verse 19. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who resists his will? If he's sovereign, then why am I being held accountable for my sin or my faults? If God is the one who made everything and I am a product of his creation, shouldn't God be to blame? You do know people talk like that, right? People feel like that. But I think in this context, Paul is the one raising this question. Paul is the one anticipating somebody's thinking like that. So Paul just starts to talk out loud and say what other folk have in their mind. I'll get there before you do. Listen to this. The only reason why people resist God's will is so they can exert their own. That's why people resist God, because they have their own agendas. And who is God to stand in my way? Pray with me, will you? Father, I trust today as always, and this is my heart's desire. Let your word be handled accurately, carefully, clearly, and thoroughly. And if that's true, Father, I believe and I trust that your word will go out. It will take root in someone's heart, in their mind. It will accomplish that which only you can do. Liberate the lost. Clear up confusion. Break down stony hearts and solid wall barriers in the minds of men and women. Create a desire for yourself in people, Lord. And let people hear the gospel and be set free. I pray for your will in every heart, every mind, every soul, under the sound of my voice, wherever it will ring. And I ask for your will to be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me just read the full text. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? Who resists his will? Romans 9:20 says, on the contrary, who are you? I love that. Oh, man who answers back to God, the thing molded will not say to the molder, why do you make me like this? Will it? Verse 21, or does the potter have a right over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for common use? I want to talk about an objection to God's sovereignty today. You see, I think this is another one of Paul's rhetorical questions. And I don't think he directly answers it, but he poses it, he raises it, he sets the tone without giving someone else the opportunity to interject. And ideally here, the real issue is the sovereignty of God and people wanting to exert their own free will. And since I have free will, well, I want to freely express it. Don't want to be constrained. And in the course of Paul making his argument for the sovereignty of God, he is saying to the Roman audience and the church there, listen, listen, God is holy, God is just, God is right in what he's doing. And when it comes to God and man, God is holy, and every man, every woman, every child is a sinner. Nobody stands on the same par or level with God. It's God and us. And without the love and the grace of God, it really could just be God. Because he is not required to save anybody. You want to catch this theologically, people, in the book of Romans. Paul is trying to tell everybody there are no innocent people. We like to see ourselves differently than we really are. In fact, that ought to be one of the things we ought to get rid of in the house. Every one of those mirrors. We spend a lot of time prepping and pumping and preparing, but that's not who we really are. We spend an awful lot of money on clothes, shoes. Be with me today, Lord. Socks, hats, that's not really who we are. God is holy, God is just, God is sovereign, and God is right in what he's doing. And at best, we're sinners. And yet, the question gets raised then, well, why does he still find fault? Well, who in fact can resist the will of God? Since he's sovereign, he's all-powerful, he's all-knowing, what are we going to do? I want you to catch this. I want you to see it. Listen to what he says in verse 20. Because I see this is an answer, but it comes back in the form of a contrast. He says in verse 19, you will say to me then, you know, why? Why and who? But in verse 20, he takes the contrast. He says, on the contrary, I heard that. In fact, I raised it. But I want you to think about this. Who are you? Just stop with me right there for a moment. Who are we? When we start to think about God and his sovereignty, and we become indignant and we want to know from God, why do you do what you do? Why do you make me like this? Or why do you do things like that? Or why am I not like this person? Or why can't I have that? Or why can't I express myself? Paul just simply asked him back. And listen, I think this is the place to start. Who am I when it comes to who God is? You know what this reminds me of? This reminds me of the idea that not only is God sovereign and we as people are insignificant in terms of our origin. We were made from dirt. Without the breath of God being blown into that pile of red dirt, we would still be a pile of red dirt. God is eternal, all-powerful, all-knowledgeable. He is love. He is justice. He's mercy. He's kindness. He's long-suffering. And we are finite. We are simply finite beings. You have a birthday. I know some of us have stopped celebrating birthdays because we don't want to be reminded. But you have a birthday. That birth date is the beginning of your physical life. You have another date. You will keep this one. You will not be late for this appointment. Death is coming for us all. That is not true with God. He has no beginning. He has no ending. He exists by himself, of himself, without subsistence from anyone. But we have a beginning. We have an ending. Now, I look at this, and if you look in verse 20 again, he says, oh man, if you can really begin to see yourself, he says, oh man, who answers back to God? In that God is the creator, and you are the created being, who are you to answer God? Think about it with me. Whatever level of intelligence we have, I don't care what high school, two-year college, university, or higher schools of education that you acquired, it really doesn't matter. The abilities that you have, you derive them from God. The fact that humanity has knowledge is simply an indication of the gift of God. That you have a mind that can think, or a mind that problem solves, or a mind that is sensitive to the needs of others, you have a gift from God. And it is God who created you with these abilities, gifts, and talents. There are people, because of the moral character of God and that capacity to which he transferred a moral conscience to humanity, can honestly say, I did it. I was wrong. I know that I was wrong. We have the ability to discern right from wrong. That is a God-given gift. That is a God-given ability. Who are you? And who is the person that can answer back to God? Is God righteous and right when he judges? How can the very beings that he created begin to try to question God? I don't know. There are people who say there are no bad questions. And maybe technically when you are talking one-on-one with each other, and maybe even before God, there's latitude there in terms of being able to question. But I want to ask you to consider something with me. Not how you see it from your perspective, not how we as people, as human beings see it, but what it must be like to get God's vantage point and to make all of the universe, create a human being, and then be able to have that human being you created question you. See, some of us are from a different generation. In my generation, the baby boomer generation, when you got old enough to start questioning your mother and father, you would need to be gainfully employed. You should have your own place. You had to have some degree of independence because you was going to have to go. You was going to have to leave the house soon, quicker than you started opening your mouth, really. Wonder what it must be like to be God and experience the very beings you created having the audacity to question you. And not just be questioned by people. Just stay with the flow. Not just be questioned by people, Narmeen, but for God to be questioned by sinners. Now, you with me? See, we see ourselves differently. But when you stand in God's light, look in verse 21. He goes on to say, now, how or does not the potter have a right? Since people are talking about their rights, you hear a lot about that these days. Does not the potter have a right over the clay? And he's simply asking this question. Who is the authority figure here? Who is sovereign here? Is it God, the potter, in this metaphor? Or is it man in his own self-will and autonomy? Paul is simply saying God is sovereign. And I want to show you something. This is why I value being in a church that honors the Word of God, is hungry for the truth, wants to hear the Word of God beyond and above any person, but just wants to hear the Word of God. And the responsibility of that is to be able to teach the Word of God, communicate the Word of God, and not my dream from last night. Listen to the Word of God. Listen to the authority, not just another scripture. But I want to ask you to listen and just hear the authority of God's Word. I'm going to take you through a couple passages where this context that Paul is sharing in chapter 9 is used in multiple other Old Testament places. And I want you to get a grip. I want you to get a feel for what the Old Testament writers talked about when they talked about God being the potter, Israel being the clay, and how God in his sovereignty is right in doing what he does. And we would be better off saying, Lord, I submit, rather than starting to ask why. Listen to the Word of God. Isaiah 29, Old Testament passage, prophet Isaiah. Listen to what he says, verse 16. Isaiah 29, 16. You turn things around. Shall the potter be considered as equal with the clay? That what is made say to its maker, he did not make me. Or what is formed say to him who formed it, he has no understanding. See, if I was God and I was making man, I would do it like this. You can say that to your boss at work. It wouldn't even be wise to do that. You could say it to the guy you work next to. But if the owner of the company shows up and you go telling the owner, listen, you don't know what you're doing, you're going to be unemployed. You're going to be unemployed. You're getting ready to go right into the statistics of the unemployed. No. Isaiah 45 and 9. Sometimes we look at things and we only see it from one perspective. Listen to the authority in God's Word. Isaiah 49 and verse 9, and the A part of the verse is really what I'm after. Woe to the one who quarrels with his maker. Do you hear him? Be careful if you want to quarrel with God. An earthenware vessel among the vessels of earth, Will the clay say to the potter, what are you doing? Or the thing you are making say, he has no hands. How's he going to fix me? As though they don't know that God doesn't need hands. As though they don't understand he made everything that exists simply by speaking a word. He didn't have to touch a thing. He created ex nihilo, something out of nothing. Didn't need any advice, didn't need any help. He didn't need a carpenter to pull out a tape to be able to measure the board and cut it. He didn't ask anybody, what are any trees? He just made something. Who are you? Who are you? How can you say you didn't make me right? See, even a little bit is a lot if it's in the right hands. Wherever you're at, whoever you are, whatever you have, that's your portion. And if you have what God has given, you lack nothing, not in his hands. Look at chapter 64 in Isaiah and verse 8. I'm just wanting you to hear the word of God. Get an impact for how Paul uses it in chapter 9. He says in Isaiah 64 and 8, but now, listen to the tone now, but now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. And you are our potter. And all of us are the work of your hand. Do you see the change? Do you get a feel that somehow or another somebody in Israel is trying to get the right message? Isaiah is letting them know what has befallen us is on us. And God is just, and God is right, God is sovereign in his dealings with man. If man would just simply repent and turn to him, he can fix your mess up. He can fix that lump of clay. And he can mold it in a manner, in a way, it will be amazing. I want to get out of this, and I want to just look at two verses in Jeremiah. Brother Dave read it for us, but I want you to see it. Jeremiah 18 and verses 5 and 6. Look at this for a moment. This is where he's at in Romans 9, 21. Prophet Isaiah puts it like this. Now, then the word of the Lord came. It came to me saying, can I not, O house of Israel, deal with you as the potter does? I'm sovereign. I am the creator of this universe. I am the originator of all humanity, declares the Lord. Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. You are in better hands than Allstate. You're in better hands than anything or anyone else. I've promised to do good by you. I've promised to bless you. That can happen. Let's go back into Romans 9. And I want to try to give you a vision on how we walk out of verse 21. He just simply says, does not the potter have a right over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for common use? Is not God sovereign? Is he not right and just in his actions? And you know, when people start to think right, you see things completely different. See, you'll never be able to understand God fully. I will never be able to understand God completely in everything that he does because I'm a finite being. We are finite beings. But when you start thinking right, you get on the right track as well. So even though every now and then I'm talking to myself, Donald,
And I'm chewing stuff over in my mind and start spilling out my mouth because I'm in it and I'm thinking about it. And I even start to answer myself. You know, when I'm really thinking right, it's when I realize how I treat other people. Be with me today, Lord. And probably more than that, Rodney, it's bigger than just that. It's bigger than that, Bob. It's bigger than how I treat other people. How we treat God. You see, if God was not just and right and righteous in his dealings with man, we would none of us be here. Because the way we treat God is raw and raunchy.
We didn't come in this world loving God with all our heart, all our mind, and all of our strength. We put that energy into ourselves. And I loved my sin. And I loved sinning. And that's where God found me, in my sin. We don't really, as a human race, love to worship. As a little boy, I was dragged out to church. It was my grandmother that drugged me to church, and it was not an option. I would have rather stayed home and watched the cartoons, sneak in the kitchen, get in my mother's pot before dinner time if I could. But it was my grandmother who was the spiritual leader, and she took me and my two little brothers, and she took us to church. It wasn't worship that I loved. I was scared to say no. It was too little. It was just, we got whoopings in our house. You just, you know, no. We're not born into this world loving God's word. We don't go to the Bible as sinners and just say, I want to just chew up. I want to be able to chew on. I want to digest the word of God and have my mind saturated with the word of God. Many churches around the world today, we just rather the preacher just teach it and tell him he did a good job. I got some OBA students in here this morning finishing up their projects, Bob, on that Bible study methods program, and they, for the first time in their lives, started really chewing the word of God and developing a system on how to approach God and study God's word, something that will help you get exactly what Jeremiah delivered. Thus saith the Lord. We're too far down the road to try to just make stuff up. You need to be able to go to the scriptures and receive the information from the mind of God that God gave that first audience through that first speaker. We're not born with a heart for God's word. How many of y'all still fall asleep on your knees in prayer? Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. Come on. Y'all go leave here and think about this later, okay? Still falling asleep on your prayer time? How many of y'all still got the cell phone on and it goes off and you feel justified coming out of prayer to answer the phone? It's just your girlfriend. Be with me today, Lord. Man, we are born with a bent going the opposite direction from God. We are born with a sin nature that leaves us in rebellion against God. We are born into this world with sin that makes us enemies with God. And if you think right, if you see yourself properly, you cannot be in conflict with the righteousness of God, the sovereignty of God, and the decisions that he makes when you consider who you are and how you treat God. Do you know that we are a people? We do not like to sin alone. We're going to find us a friend. And me and my friend, we're going to sin. I'm going to sin until he sinned against me, and then I'm going to be mad with him and find me a new friend. Y'all not with me today. Somebody ought to say amen, Pastor. If you were thinking right, we would recognize how we treat one another is wrong. Are you paying? And it's almost heartbreaking to listen to the news anymore. But are you listening to what's going on in America? Another mass shooting. Some guy goes into his workplace armed with, 2, 3, 9 millimeter pistols with 30 rounds, a 30-round clip. You know, the thing's got to be that long. And he goes
goes into his workplace and he just shoots up everybody. He targeted people specifically that upset him. People are not thinking right. If we were thinking better, if we were thinking clearly, if we were in our right mind, the way we treat one another is an indication of how far our hearts are from God. I had an occasion one time to tell a friend of my son, they were in high school at the time. They were close friends, and they played basketball together. And as teenagers, you know, I didn't think I liked some of the things that I was observing. And my son's friend came to the house, and he and I got to talking. Somehow or another, my son went inside, and he and I were in the backyard together. And we just sat there, and I just looked him in his eye, and I said, "Hey, you know, listen, are you really friends with my son?" "Oh, yeah, Mr. Haynes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're close. We're all that. Let me ask you something. Can you be better than just a friend? Could you be a good friend to him? Could you be good enough to tell him, hey, man, we're not going to do this? Could you tell him, I'm close enough to you, I'm close enough in concern about you that I won't stand by and let you do this or that?" I ask him, what kind of a friend are you? Are you a friend that enables another so-called friend to do whatever because it's what you like and you're common with and you identify with somebody who's doing the same stuff you are and both of you headed the wrong direction? You know how people get when you kind of get a little close to him? And he kind of cringed in his seat. After a while, I looked around, he was slouching in the little seat. It was clear he was uncomfortable. What kind of friend are you? Are you a good enough friend to say, "I'm not doing that. No, I'm not going." And neither are you. Are you the kind of friend who's willing to make a friend, even of somebody who may be living differently than you, but you have the courage to befriend them, get close to them, and not do what they do? Love them. Care for them. Serve them. And be the light in their life. Be a good friend. Guy goes into the job and shoots up everybody. He targeted people at that workplace that either had offended him or something about their life offended him. And I don't know if any of you guys have had this problem. I'm not a big Facebook person. We got on Facebook when we got kicked out of the building in COVID. Anybody who's been sending me messages on Facebook before that knew I wasn't answering. But every now and then, you know, when I check now and I look back, you know, you can see things on Facebook and you see some of the most craziest things that people will say. They feel completely comfortable and shielded to be able to say whatever's on their mind on Facebook and Twitter and some of these other social media platforms. And if people were thinking right, what they say and what they do and how they treat others, they wouldn't do that. And so Paul just kind of boils it down. God has a right over the clay, and he's sovereign, and he can develop some for honorable use and others for common use. Here's the good news in my mind. We live in the era of grace, where the grace of God broke the cycle of sin, potentially for every person who was born into the world. God, by grace, sent Jesus Christ to Calvary to die and pay the sin debt for all of humanity and anyone who believes in him. That sin cycle can be broken by faith in Christ alone. We live in the era of grace where a just person voluntarily laid their life down to pay the debt of an unjust person. You and me. He did that on our behalf. And you know the wonderful thing about it, Ken? We didn't even have good sense to ask him. He knew what we need. He did what needed to be done. Does not God have the right? God is sovereign, even if we object. In fact, if we start thinking correctly, we would stop objecting. We would start worshiping. If we start thinking right, we would start studying the Word of God and get the marrow out of the bone. If we start thinking right, we will pray with sincerity, honesty, and we will pray until heaven moves and not be moved. We will love one another. We will respect one another. We'll be patient with one another, long-suffering with each other. We will be able to endure because we live in this era of grace where the presence of God's Spirit indwells every believer, and we have the power to do so. Church gets different then. People start hungering for the Word of God. People start desiring the Word of God. The Word of God becomes the standard in the lives of the people of God. The authority that God has invested in His children, in His servants, will be seen in service and love. You know, I used to work for a company that had as its motto, "Everybody deserves common decency." What does that look like in the church? What does that look like in the family of God? Where we love one another, not just ourselves. Where our love for God is seen in how we love each other, not just ourselves. Where who we are is not determined on where we live, or how much we make, or what kind of vehicle you drive, but on the power of God moving in your life, drawing you nearer to Him, changing and transforming you into Christ's likeness, building you up, bringing honor and glory to God by your life, by your life. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, I thank you today. Who are we? We are sinners saved by grace. Because of your love, we've come into our right mind. We are thinking with the mind of Christ. Who are we? We are now, because of our faith in Jesus, the family of God, the bride of Jesus Christ, the church at large in the era of grace, set free to be able to share the good news of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ so that many others can come to faith. Who are we? We are your product. And what we have is what you have supplied. And what you have given is simply enough. And we are thankful and we are grateful because you loved us. You called us. You've given us the privilege of being able to serve you through serving people. And we give you the honor and we give you the glory and we give you the praise today. And so I thank you for the privilege this morning, dear Lord, of studying your word. And I pray that its effect will be far and wide. It will go deep. And I pray, Father, it takes root. And when we look in the mirror next, we will see you and not just ourselves. And if need be, Father, we'll see our sin and come confessing that sin to you, trusting you not just for forgiveness, but transformation. You be the glory.
To you be the honor. To you be the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I bless you all today. Thank you.